good morning, one and all.
Morning.
Everybody doing good?
Yes.
It's a wonderful day at Bread of Life, a wonderful day at Bread of Life. Won't you be mine? Everybody had a great week?
Yes.
Good, good, good. How many joined in on, I know Angie was there. I know Leslie was on Faith Life. Anybody else join in on Faith Life? Oh, Cameron was on. No. Okay, good, good, good. Good attendance then. All right. Well, it is a wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord, and I hope you guys came ready to worship today. We are online. If you are joining us online this morning, please let us know. There should be a button there that says connect. If you'll click on that, you'll be taken to a form that you can quickly let us know that you are with us this morning. If you are a first-time guest, there should also be one there that says first-time guest. If you would do me the favor of filling that out and letting me know, I want to be able to connect with you. And the only way that I can know that you're with us, the only way I can know how to even connect with you is if you take a moment to fill that out. So if you would, I very much would appreciate you letting us know that. We do have Sunday school going on every Sunday morning at 9:30. Cameron has got his class that's happening, and we've got an end time prophecy. We kind of made a turned a corner today. Well, I told him we graduated from end time 101 into 201, taking a little bit deeper look at prophecies and the things that are going to happen. We've also got a Bible study that happens on Wednesday evenings. Now, you did not have it last Wednesday because of distribution. You will be on this Wednesday. And then we've also got Leslie's Bible study that happens on Tuesday evenings. At what time?
6 o'clock.
So if you're interested in attending either one of those options are available to you. Looks like I did not take Faith Life out, so I'm moving on from there. Giving, there is a plate there in the back. If you could just continue your faithfulness and tithing. We also have an online option. You can go through tithe.ly, and sign up there to pay online. So there are a couple of different options that are available to you. Of course, the standard mail still works, as I understand, although I got to tell you, it took a week for me to get my coffee. It was supposed to have been in last Monday, and I didn't get it until Saturday, and I ran out, and I'm like, where's my coffee? I need my coffee. So mail was kind of running late on us, but we're starting to see things come back now that the snowcopalypse is over. All right. Well, let's pray this morning and get ready to worship. Father, you're awesome and mighty, and I am so grateful that you give us this opportunity to come together as a family, as a not just a group of individuals, of believers, but we come in this place as a group of believers, as a family of believers. We come together as the Bread of Life Church of the Nazarene. And I pray, Father, that you would come and establish your throne on our praises this morning. It's what your word tells us, and I'm standing on your promises today. Father, as we enter into our time of music, I just ask that you would come and move amongst us today. Let us know that you are with us, and that whatever our needs are, we can bring it to the very feet of Christ, to the foot of the cross, and know that it will be taken care of. I thank you for Ryan and the worship team and their faithfulness. I pray, God, that you would move in their lives today, a fresh anointing in their lives as they lead us in worship and lead us to the very throne today. Again, Father, I do thank you, and I give you all praise and all honor. Amen.
Good morning. Let's lift his name on high. Lift your name on high.
The God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. My God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs.
Turn it for good.
what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. See a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory.
I will trust in you.
should walk through, when you don't give the answers as I cry out to you. I will trust in you. I will trust in you. I will trust in you.
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for today, Lord. Each one of us here will trust in you through all of our days, Lord. Just help us to always know that you are with us, whatever comes our way. We know that you are so powerful and mighty, and there's nothing you can't do. There's nothing impossible for you. We just ask that you just bless this service. Help to reach the hearts of all those listening in this morning. Help to be you speaking through Brother Lay, that we might hear your word and share it with others, Lord. And we just ask that you just help us to listen to these words that we sing to you this morning. We want to praise you. We want to love you. We want to lift our voices with all our hearts to you, Lord. And we just ask all these things in your name. Amen.
Amen.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well, and your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. Accepted, you were condemned, and I'm alive and well, and your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be my King would die for me? Amazing love, I know. life for me. Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you. And it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do.
With our hearts, with our voice, with our hands. Father, you are amazing. All that you've done for us, Lord God, your provisions of salvation through the grace, through your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord God, today that we stand forgiven. We thank you today, God, that our sins have been blotted out, wiped away. We're not the way we were. We're not the people that we were. I thank you that you're our King today. And as our King, Lord Jesus, we honor you. We give you thanks. We give you our hearts. We give you our adoration today. We lay our crowns at your feet. You are worthy of all praise and worthy of all worship. You are our King, God. You are our King. Be seated. Oh, you know, I always enjoy when I get up here and I look back and it's filled up. It is good to see all of you here today. Amen. I've got some of you that have signed up for our 21 Days of Hope. I want to quickly remind you that just because I happen to have your name and your phone does not mean that you will be signed up for our 21 Days of Hope. You will need to do that yourself. All right? It's your choice. So all you need to do is text the word HOPE, to 903-207-5947, and that will put you into that group. What is the 21-day hope, you ask? Man, I am so glad that you asked that, Angie. Well, it's 21 days, and it will begin on March 14th. And it's 21 days of hope. Each day you will receive an email, a message, and each one will have a goal. It will be something like hope to you. Today's goal is hope to you, and it will be a devotional for you to read and study. And within it, it will have a difficulty level from 1 star up to 10 stars. And it could be something really simple like a devotional and reading this thing and praying about it. Or it could be the goal being hope through you, right? So it's not just hope to you, but it's hope that's working through you to others. So in other words, it's a mission. And we're going on a digital mission of sorts. So when you get these that say today's goal is hope through you, well, there's something that you've got to do. And again, it will have a difficulty rating anywhere from 1 star all the way up to 10 stars. Here's an example. And this is a hope through you. Today we want you to think about, pray about, and ask God to give you 3 names of individuals, or maybe it's 5 names, I don't remember now, and just write them down on a piece of paper. Write them in a notebook and put it away for future use. That's all you got to do, and pray about them. Pray for them, right? That's it. How simple is that? Or maybe that hope to you involves something else, like texting. Right, one of those will be take those names that you just wrote down and just send them a text message. Say, hey, I was thinking about you. Just want to know that I was thinking about you and I'm praying for you. That's pretty simple. Right? There's nothing really difficult about this. Or maybe it's getting onto social media and making a post, liking something or loving something. Right? Loving one of the posts from Bread of Life that I'm trying to get put out on a regular basis. Little things like that. And there's opportunities for us to grow as a church, as a body of believers, to find hope in Christ as we go along. So you are invited to join us on that digital missions trip. And I'll get you more information as we go along. You know, in the next couple of weeks, we'll start sharing a little bit more. But on March 14th, it kicks off. So if you're going to be a part of it, you need to text the word HOPE to 903-207-5947, which is the church's text number, and join up on that. It is your choice. So we started off last week in Lent. It's not the stuff in your belly button, right? We're talking about Christ and the message of the cross, the message of Christ. We're talking about forgiveness. That was the predominant message of Christ. Repent. Be saved. And this morning, we're looking at a text today of Matthew chapter 9 and the proclamation, your sins are forgiven. Last week, we looked at a practical faith. And we talked about the man that had the greatest faith of all. Greatest faith ever recorded in Scripture. And Jesus said, I tell you the truth, I have not seen any faith like this in all of Israel. Who was that man? Well, he was the Roman centurion. Somebody completely outside of Jewish religion. He was a Gentile, an outsider, a Roman. But yet Jesus said of this man, I tell you, I haven't seen any faith like this. This man is great among faith. And he goes on, and when he's telling Jesus about his servant. Jesus says, well, I'll go heal him. And we realize that what happened at that moment, and I can just imagine the folks that were around Jesus in that moment when Jesus says, I'll go heal him, man, they had been completely, wow, this is wrong. Somebody failed to give Jesus the rules of the things that he can do and the things he can't do. This is not what good Jewish boys do, or Jewish girls for that matter. We don't go into the home of a Gentile, especially a Roman centurion. And the centurion says, no. You don't have to come to my home. All you need to do is say the word. And I'm astounded in this. As I read it and I thought about it, the idea that somebody that has no understanding of the Torah, has no understanding of scriptures, that this man somehow understood who Jesus Christ was and the authority that Jesus Christ had. Not in just speaking to someone and telling them to go. Right? The Roman centurion says, look, I'm a man under authority. I understand what that's like. And not only am I a man under authority, but I have people underneath me that are in authority to me. I tell them to go, and they go. I tell my servant to do something, and my servant does it. So he's got that understanding. And this guy somehow understands the authority that Jesus Christ has, not in saying, Ryan, I need you to go up here and play right now, and expecting Ryan to get up here and do that. He has an understanding that most Christians today don't, that Jesus Christ is the authority figure, not of individuals, but of the entire universe. Everything falls under the authority of Jesus Christ. Heaven and hell, life and death, sickness and health. Right? It all falls under the authority of Jesus Christ. How in the world he got that, I don't know. Maybe he was there when Jesus got off the boat and the leper showed up and said, you know, hey, here I am, I need healing, and Jesus heals him. Again, against cultural norms. And Jesus heals him. Maybe he saw that and he recognized, wow, this is a man of authority. Again, I don't know. Scripture doesn't tell us. But all I know is that this man had the greatest faith ever recorded in the Bible. Jesus says that. Well, this morning, we're going to look at another text here in Matthew chapter 9. And again, it talks about healing. But this healing goes beyond anything physical. Yes, the guy is healed physically. But this healing, it goes beyond that. It's something greater, something bigger. And much like the previous week's story, where Jesus stepped out of the societal, cultural norms of the day, Jesus does something else in this passage that is even bigger, an even bigger moment. And we're going to walk through this, beginning at verse 1 and working all the way through through verse 8. And each one gives us little nuggets, gives us some new understandings. But it all focuses on one thing, the word forgiven. And that is a sweet word. It's an awesome word to hear somebody tell you you're forgiven. It's yesterday I was visiting with friends. And this young lady, I've known her since she was, probably Addie's age. No, Abby's age. Probably Abby's age. And her and her dad had a falling out. Really ugly falling out. And I only asked, you know, how's your dad? I knew he had heart surgery, had a pacemaker put in. And I was only asking her about that, and she began to spill a lot of stuff. I said, look, I'm not trying to pry. I just asked about your dad because I was concerned. But in the midst of that, she's telling me that well, you know, we've had a falling out, and I've forgiven him. Well, that's good news. You've forgiven him. I just don't want anything to do with him. Now, that's not complete forgiveness. That's just a partial thing, a Band-Aid. And I didn't speak to her about that. It was not the opportune time, not the moment. But the idea of forgiving somebody the way Christ has forgiven us is so beautiful. To know that I am forgiven, to know that you're forgiven. And we're going to walk through this morning. Before we read, let's just go to Christ real quick and ask him to bring revelation. Father, I thank you again. And I pray, Father, that as we begin to walk through Scripture today, that you would open our ears to hear you speaking to us. I pray, Father, that you would open our minds to understand and comprehend what you're telling us. I don't want it to just go in one ear and out the other, God. I want it to stay. I want it to stick. I want to understand what you're telling me. Because, Father, if you've had it recorded, then it's important. And I need to know that. I need to understand that. We need to know it. We need to understand it. I pray, Father, that you would send your Spirit to write it on our hearts. Not just a thought, but write it on our hearts, Father, that it would become embedded in us, become part of who we are, part of our DNA. Father, I'm praying today for a fresh anointing of your Spirit as I bring your word. I don't want yesterday's anointing. I need today's anointing. I can't do this on my own. I acknowledge that, and I need you. So Holy Spirit, come work through me today. Fresh wind and a fresh fire. Amen. All right, so we're going to Matthew chapter 9, and we're going to begin in verse number 1. And it says, Jesus climbed into a boat and went back across the lake to his own town. Huh? And so if you recall from last week, Jesus had gone to the Gadarenes, right? And he heals a man of the demons that are in him. They say, thanks, but no thanks. We want you to leave. Get out of here. And Jesus climbs in his boat and heads back across the sea to his hometown. And as far as we know, Jesus never went back to the Gadarenes. Nothing in Scripture gives us any indication that he ever went back. He honored their promise, which to me says volumes. It says that, look, when we reject Christ, he says, okay, if that's what you want, I'm stepping back. So we all have a choice. We can either serve Christ or we can deny Christ. Hell is not full of people that Christ has denied. Hell is full of people that have denied Christ. Key difference. Christ didn't deny them. They denied Christ. So here we are. Parallel story. Jesus climbs in his boat and goes back across the lake to his own town. Verse 2. Some people brought to him a paralyzed man on a mat. Seeing their faith, Jesus said to the paralyzed man, be encouraged, my child. Your sins are forgiven. Now, here's where Jesus starts getting messed up, starts getting in trouble again, another fashion mess up, as he gets in trouble with the religious leaders of the day. Recalling again, he's come back from the Gadarenes, and here he is. He gets off the boat, and it tells us that a paralyzed man has been brought to him. Now, this account is a parallel account. We find the same thing, same story in Mark chapter 2 and in Luke chapter 5. It's the exact same story, just told from a different viewpoint. And I'm also going to tell you that Matthew, who is recording this at this point in time, is kind of on the fringe. He has yet to become a disciple. He's on the fringe. Have you ever seen the series, The Chosen? Right, it's a great series. It's like 7 episodes, maybe 8 episodes. It's worth watching. It's really good. And it's about Christ. And it talks about, or goes through the calling of the disciples. And in this particular episode, Jesus is teaching. And you can see Matthew, along with Peter, sitting on a rooftop across the street listening. Now, in Mark and Luke, it adds us some more details. It's not a matter of Jesus has just stepped off the boat, and here they come with this paralyzed man. In Mark and Luke, we get additional information that Jesus is inside of a home, and he begins to teach. He's probably somewhere into his third point, and he's getting ready to close in this message when the people or the friends bring this particular individual, this paralyzed man, before Christ. So he's teaching in a home, and the fire marshal shows up and said, "Man, you got too many people here. Somebody's going to have to leave." And they start filling out into the streets, and they open up the doors, and they open up the windows. They didn't have amplification back then, so they didn't have a mic. But they open the doors up, they open the windows up, and Jesus continues to teach as the city streets is now full. And that's the scene then. Matthew is across the way on a housetop along with Peter, and they're listening to Jesus. And he begins his teaching, and the man is lowered down through the roof. Now, anybody ever gone and rode the Judge Roy Bean there at Six Flags, right? Or maybe it's some other the rock and roller coaster at Disney. Oh, man, that's awesome, right? And you've got these long lines that you've got to work your way through. And you're right there on the verge of going into the building. Your turn is really close. You're right there on the verge of it, and somebody turns and is waving at somebody behind them. "Come on up, come on up." And you've been in line now for an hour waiting on your turn, and they motion to have somebody come up front. How do you feel? You're not real happy about it. You know that they weren't saving that position for them. They just happened to see somebody back there they knew and say, "Come on up." Well, this man and his friends broke through the crowd. They pushed through. Didn't wait their turn. Said, "I'm getting up here first. I'm going to go first." And they broke through the roof and lowered the man right down. Like I said, Jesus was probably on his third point. He's getting ready to close. And God brings the illustration of everything that he's been talking about. What a great way to illustrate or to end the story, other than this man coming down so that Christ can do exactly what he's been teaching. And he says, "Be of good cheer, young man. Your sins are forgiven." Oh, I could just hear as he makes that statement. Who is this man that can forgive sins? When you think about the contrast between making the lame walk, the blind to see, the deaf to hear, that seems somewhat less than spectacular when he says your sins are forgiven. But this right here far outweighs any demonstration of Jesus' authority in the universe. It far outweighs everything that he's done by this forgiveness of sins. And it's what gets him in trouble with the religious leaders. So let's go on. Verse 3. But some of the teachers of the religious law said to themselves, "That's blasphemy. Does he think he's God?" You see? He's in trouble now. He's in trouble all because of that simple thing, that simple statement, "Your sins are forgiven." Frederick Dale Bruner, in his commentary on Matthew, writes, "People cannot just go around telling other people that God holds nothing against them. Claiming to know and to deliver divine amnesty comes close to presumption. Yet Jesus authoritatively tells another human being how he stands with God." This act that Jesus goes through, this act of forgiveness, so unsettles the Pharisees, the scribes, the religious leaders, that they say, "Man, this is an act of blasphemy. Who does he think he is, God?" They hear this slandering of God and the claims that he has the same authority as God to forgive sins. When in reality, it is this forgiveness that gives witness to the authority Jesus has and shares with the Father. Right? This forgiveness, this act, shows that he and the Father are one and the same. So it's understandable why they're so upset. This paralyzed man is then made right simply based on his faith and the faith of a group of friends. He's free because of Christ through faith. Now, wait a minute. This is before Calvary, right? Calvary hasn't happened. Jesus hasn't died. The blood has not been shed. This is pre-Calvary. So how does God how does Christ have this authority? How can this man be saved? Well, the same way we are. We are saved through faith. The same way that the men and women of the Old Testament were saved. You look in Hebrews, and he talks about their faith. And their faith is what was used as their righteous covering and their salvation. We are saved by the grace of God through faith. The grace of God is the giving of his Son, Jesus Christ. And it's our faith in receiving that, in believing that, that gives us salvation. It's faith. And that's the thing that's happening here with this man. And his friends that show up, they have faith in who Jesus Christ is. They have faith in his authority. Now, what they didn't expect was for Jesus to say, "Hey, buddy, your sins are forgiven." I'm sure that caught them off guard too. But it reveals to them the authority that Jesus Christ has, the oneness of who he is with God the Father and forgiving his sins. So all the religious leaders are now up in arms, and let's go to verse 4. Jesus knew what they were thinking. Wow. Jesus knew what they were thinking? Now in Judaism, the ability to know the thoughts of others is ascribed to God alone. Oh, didn't know that. But here it says Jesus knew what they were thinking. So that tells us again, he's God. Him and the Father are one and the same. So for them to be telling them their thoughts would only be possible if indeed Jesus was truly God. So let's go on with this. Jesus knew their thinking, so he asked them, "Why do you have such evil thoughts in your heart?" Verse 5 and 6. "Is it easier to say your sins are forgiven or stand up and walk? So I will prove to you that the Son of Man has the authority on earth to forgive sins." And he turns to the man, to the paralyzed man, "Stand up, pick up your mat, and go home." Know that there is no visible, something that you can see, visible evidence when Jesus said, "Your sins are forgiven." He looks the same. He's still laying on the mat. There's no visible evidence as to the fact that Jesus has now forgiven his sins and his standing before God is complete. That he's in good standing. The debts are paid. There's no evidence of that. And the religious leaders are all up in arms. This is blasphemy against God. Right? They're all upset about it. And Jesus says, "Look, I know your thoughts, and they're evil. They're wrong. Which is easier, for me to say your sins are forgiven or to get up and walk? Well, just to show you that I have the authority to do this, to forgive sins, get up. Get up, pick up your mat, go home." And the crowd at that moment had to have been in such awe. The religious leaders, the Pharisees, the scribes, when they saw that, I can just... as they march off. I'm sorry, Pepper. As they march off in this, because they're undone. It's Jesus. Now, I don't know, but I'm kind of wondering, is this the start of the offensive culture that we see today? All right, Mr. Potato Head, have you seen that one? Mr. Potato Head, they're offended by that, so they're talking about dropping it. There are some others that are in the news that it's just really, seriously, the offensive culture of today. And I got to wonder if maybe this is where it all started with the Pharisees. They're offended by Jesus and they storm off. And we got the cancel culture today. If we don't agree with something, we cancel it. So the scribes and the Pharisees went back and the scribes are writing down, hashtag cancel Jesus. Maybe that's when it all started. But they march off in despair, having been defeated, having their hot air let out. Because in that moment, Jesus says, "I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you the authority. Get up and walk." And it becomes irrefutable proof at that moment as to Jesus' authority to not just physical sickness, but to heal not just physical sickness, but to heal a spiritual sickness. Something that is at the very core of humanity. And you know the great thing about it? Is the man picked up his mat and walked home, and the glory of God was revealed. Last verse. And the man jumped up and went home. Man, that is so cool. The man jumped up and went home, and fear swept through the crowd as they saw this happen, and they praised God for giving humans such authority. The glory of God was revealed in this very moment. That not only does Jesus have the authority to forgive, but he has the authority over physical sickness as well. What a radical difference. As with everything that Jesus does, it does require something on our part. And in this case, he says, get up, go home, pick up your mat and go home. And the man did that. He put it to action. He put his faith in Jesus into action. When Christ tells us something, when the Holy Spirit begins to reveal something to you, telling you something that that you're needing to do or that God is wanting you to do, you have two choices. Act on it or don't act on it. It's your choice. I will tell you this. The moment that the Holy Spirit begins to reveal to you something that God is wanting from you, that is your moment. That is your moment to act on it and to do it. Maybe it's in getting rid of something in your life that is affecting your walk with Him. And you're coming to that point where, okay, I need you to give this over to me. That is your moment to do it. And if you'll do it at that time, it's easy. It's done. It's over with. But if you wait, well, just give me a few more days. I really am enjoying this. Give me maybe a week. And a week he ends up and says, well, you know, maybe just a few more days. And you keep putting it off. And it becomes more and more difficult. The more you put it off, it becomes more and more difficult to release it, to do it, because it's ingraining itself in you. It's becoming part of who you are, becoming part of your DNA. The moment to release it was back there. Partial disobedience to what God is calling you to do is still disobedience. Excuse me, partial obedience is still disobedience. Partial obedience to what God is calling you to is still 100% disobedience. So when God calls you to something, you need to act on it. When God says, pick up your mat and go home, you act on it. There's something that is required on our part to do. Okay. Now I imagine this guy in that very moment as he's laying there and Jesus says, your sins are forgiven. And then he comes back and says, pick up your mat, go home. I'm thinking, this is from my standpoint, I'm thinking, okay, if I do this, I am giving up my job. I mean, he's a beggar, right? And that's the way he made a living. So if I get up, as he's telling me to do, pick up my mat and go home, I am giving up my job to do what Christ has told me to do. I don't have a way of making a living because I have no trade. I'm not a plumber like Terry. I'm not a mailman like Butch, or Butch was. I don't have these trades. I don't have those skills. So for me to stand up and take my mat and go home, as I'm being told to do, man, I don't have a way of surviving after this. But yet he does that. He gets up, takes up his mat, and goes home. Today, all of humanity is infected. You have an illness, and it is far worse than the coronavirus. It doesn't pick and choose. It's 100%. Every last man, woman, and child on the face of this earth is infected with this virus. Doesn't matter your age. It doesn't matter your gender or lack thereof. And it does not matter your race. I'm going to tell you that there is no amount of social distancing or mask that will keep you protected from this virus. There's no need to even go get a check, right? They're not going to stick a nasal swab up your nose to find out. There's no reason to go get a check. I guarantee you, you have it. And it's not just you either. It's your spouse. He or she has it. It's your kids, your siblings, brothers and sisters. It's your parents, your neighbors, your friends, your enemies. It's 100%, and it's far deadlier than anything that man has ever experienced. You can sing happy birthday while washing your hands with the most stringent of soap. And you can do this over and over and over and over. I don't care how many times you sing happy birthday, you're not going to get it off of you. The medical profession has no vaccine against this. And you are guaranteed to die from it. Wow, you're not giving me a whole lot of hope. You may already know that you have it. But now's a perfect time to remind others, to remind those here, remind those watching, of the state that we're in. Lydia Smith, you know, she does the essential oils. I'm sorry, man, but that essential oil that she gave us, that's for health, or what is antiviral, is that what it is? Right. Let me tell you, that antiviral is not going to work on this. It's good stuff. Good stuff. I'm not arguing against that. It's just that when it comes to this particular virus, it ain't going to help. From the moment of your birth, you became infected. So I guess you could say it's your mom and dad's fault. Now then, I will tell you that there is a cure. It's not in essential oils. It's not in eating healthy or having healthy habits. You can subscribe to Balance of Nature, or you can go over here to Courtney and get onto her plan. But I guarantee you, none of that is the cure. None of that affects this. The good news is, there is a cure. Our scientific community will never be able to replicate the cure. But that's okay, because there's enough of it to go around for everyone. You don't need to get shots, and you don't need to come back every 6 months for a booster. You can get the cure, it's done, it's over with. You don't need multiple shots. Jesus looked at this man just as he looks at you and I today, and he sees in us the depravity of our situation. And the disease I'm speaking of is mortality. From the moment of birth, your body begins to deteriorate. Don't believe that? Ask Angie. She's my medical professional over here. You begin to grow. Your body cells are in a continual state of decline, even in the middle of growth. And eventually you end up dying because of mortality. But the thing is, that's not the way we were originally created. We were created completely different. We were created in immortal bodies. We were created in the image of God and created to walk with God. So what happened? Sin happened. Sin happened. And when it happened, it completely changed things. It completely rewrote our DNA to where we are now mortal. As I said, there's a cure. Jesus Christ, he looked at this man, and just as he looks at us today, he sees the mortality of our bodies, he sees the depravity of our sins, and he says to us, "My child, you're forgiven." It's so simple. It's so easy. The very blood of Jesus on Calvary provides for the forgiveness of our sins. That's the good news. This morning, the great physician stands at our doors, our heart doors, knocking. Will you let him in? When I went yesterday, afterwards, I went and played judo, and when I was walking up to the dojo, there was a house at the end of the driveway, separate from the main house, and I'm thinking, well, that's the entrance into the dojo, and I'm walking towards it and realize, oh no, that's a living room. This is somebody's home. I see the mat, Grandma and Grandpa live here, so I kind of had an idea who it was. And the young lady that I was visiting with confirmed, yes, that's her mom and dad. So I stopped on my way out, knocked, the door was closed, rang the bell. I waited for a few minutes and walked away. And as I'm sitting there trying to dig my keys out of my pocket, she comes to the door. Took her, I don't know, probably 3 minutes. But she came to the door, and I went and was able to talk with her and, you know, hey, how are you doing, so on and so forth. Today, the great physician stands at your door, and he's knocking. He's waiting. Will you let him in? You don't need to throw on your good clothes. You don't need to worry about fixing your hair. Oh, somebody's at the door. You don't have to worry about that. He's just waiting for you to open the door and invite him in. Now, I mentioned this earlier, and there's another aspect of forgiveness that I want to mention to us all. See, it's not just the forgiveness of our sins. When Jesus was teaching on the Sermon on the Mount, when Jesus was teaching his disciples how to pray, he says, "And forgive us our sins as we forgive those that have sinned against us. Forgive us our debts as we forgive those that are indebted to us. Forgive our personal sins against you just as we forgive those that have wronged us." And that's the other aspect of forgiveness. You see, a lot of times, just like this young lady that I was talking with, yeah, I forgive them. I just don't want anything to do with them. I don't want to hang around with them anymore. I've been hurt in church. I've been hurt by people. I forgive them. I just don't want to go back there. I don't want anything to do with them anymore. They're a bunch of hypocrites or whatever. I appreciate the fact that you forgive. But unless Christ has spoken and said you need to leave as well, then there's some unforgiveness that's there, and there's disobedience on your part. That's a hard thing to say. is a hard thing to think about. But Jesus tells us in the same way we forgive others, that's how our Father in heaven will forgive us. So while we can speak of forgiveness of one another, yeah, forgive them. I just don't want anything to do with them. I want you to get that picture in your head. When Jesus forgave this man, he took the next step and said, get up, go home. He didn't say, your sins are forgiven, and turn around and walk away. He took the next step, the physical action of healing the man. When the leper came to him, if you're willing, oh, I'm willing, be healed. Even though it was completely against the cultural norm, he took that next step and said, you're healed. When Jesus forgives us, when God forgives us of our sins, he doesn't just, okay, I'm done, wash his hands of you. He invites you in. He invites you into the family. He invites you to become part of who he is. His son, his daughter. And God wants to forgive us in that way. But in the same way that we forgive those that have wronged us, that's how he's going to forgive us. Now, I'm going to say this too. Forgiveness, man, it's a big thing. There's a lot of complexity into this. Sometimes it just takes time. It may take weeks, months, years, decades to come to this point. This is something that the Holy Spirit is speaking to you about today. Whether you're here, whether you're watching online, and the Holy Spirit is saying, you know, you remember this? I really would like for you to give it up. Today's the day to do that. Today's the day to seek that, to ask not only of that person, but of God, forgive me for holding that. Father in heaven, I thank you for your word today. I thank you, Lord God, that our sins are forgiven. The cure for this disease that wrecks all of mankind has already been given. It already exists. And there's no worry about dosages because there's enough to go around. All we have to do is to accept and believe, to receive by faith the gift of that cure, the gift of our salvation through Jesus Christ. It's a free gift. It's for every man, every woman, every child. And today, Father, if there are those here, if there's those that are listening in, and they're not certain about their position with you, where they stand with you, then I would ask today, Father, that you would turn to them and speak to them, and that you would bring them to that point of forgiveness, to acknowledge to them, be of good cheer, my friend. You're forgiven. I pray, Father, they would have faith to act on that, to receive it, to pick up, to stand up and pick up their mat and go on. Likewise, Father, if there are those here today that somebody has wronged them, and while they say they've got forgiveness, they've given forgiveness to that individual, they're still harboring things. They still don't want anything to do with them. Today, Father, I pray that you would work in their lives as well, that you would bring restoration and healing to them. Bring them to that point that they need to be so they can be in the fullness of life with you. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you didn't just come to heal the sick, the lame, the blind, the deaf. You came, Lord Jesus, to give the ultimate cure for mankind. You gave your life up, and through that gift on Calvary, through the blood that was poured out, that today we can live in righteousness before our Father, that we can become a son and a daughter of our Lord and Savior, of our Father. I thank you for what you did, Lord God. I pray, Father, as we leave today, that you would go with us, that you would open up doors that have been closed to us in regards to sharing the gospel. Give us opportunities to be a witness for you, to you, of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This idea of forgiveness, it bears witness in our hearts and in our souls to others. So may we do that as we leave this place today, to be your witness to the world, a light and a salt to the earth. Amen and amen. You guys have a great week. Thank you for coming.